Hi everyone, today we're talking about sedimentology and stratigraphy, and we are at the third lecture in this series of SedStrat videos on my channel now. And in this lecture, we'll be focusing on the shape of grains in sedimentary rocks, specifically the sphericity of grains and how that affects their transport and what we can gain from measuring and knowing the sphericity of grains in a certain sedimentary deposit, as well as roundness and what that tells us about the sedimentary deposit and history of its deposition. And lastly, in this video, we'll talk about microsurface textures and how these surface textures like polish and frost or striations and scratches or other marks and indentations can form and what they can tell us about the environment in which that rock formed. First and foremost, sphericity, or how spherical a grain is. Sphericity of a grain heavily affects its settling velocity and basically any transport that it goes through. For this reason, many spherical grains become separated from less spherical grains of the same density and size, therefore kind of grading or sorting the sediment based on shape rather than size as we typically think about grading. For that reason, sphericity of grains is important to consider when interpreting the processes that led to the deposition of that grain or those grains. Now, sphericity, obviously, like we just mentioned, affects transport and sorting, and it's been observed that flatter pebbles are transported down beach during shore phase transport processes. I've talked about all of these processes in my shore phase depositional environment video. If you want to check it out, I'll link it up here in the right corner for you. And more spherical pebbles lag behind, aren't transported as far down beach. Another observation is that less spherical grains are typically found in beach pebbles, whereas more spherical grains are found in river pebbles. The takeaway here isn't to memorize these trends that we've observed, it's just to reinforce the idea that sphericity is just as important as specific gravity and composition when it comes to settling, transport, and sorting of grains. So why do we have this second term called roundness that we also focus on in sedimentology and determining depositional processes that led to a sedimentary rock's formation? Well, roundness is actually not a synonym to sphericity. It actually is very different than sphericity. Roundness actually probably should be named smoothness because it has nothing to do with the actual shape or sphericity of the grain. It has everything to do with kind of the smoothness or angularity on the other end of the spectrum of the grain. If it's smooth but elongated, it's still very well rounded. An elongated grain is not spherical, whereas if it's very angular and has sharp edges and corners, but it's still pretty spherical in its overall shape, then it still has high sphericity, but it's very poorly rounded, or what's termed very angular. So now that we have the difference between those two terms out of the way, what does rounding tell us about the history of that grain and deposit? Well, rounding occurs during transport and abrasion. So unlike sphericity, rounding doesn't actually affect how a grain is sorted or transported. It's more the opposite process. The transportation and therefore abrasion of that grain affects the rounding. And then obviously that can then affect its further transport. But the transport is the initial process that causes the grain to become rounded. And rounding can actually be calculated and made quantitative for more precise comparisons, but I'm not going to talk about that here. I just wanted to mention it so you know that if you are really going to go into depth in understanding the history of a sedimentary rock and you're really wanting to get some quantitative methods, you can make this a quantitative measure. But in general, for like introductory courses like this video is here, you can just look at it relatively. So you can generally say like a conglomerate has pretty rounded gravel grains, whereas a breccia is really angular, and you can see them relative to each other rather than making it quantitative, and that's good enough to get a general idea of the history of that rock. So what can we categorize these grains as when we're talking about roundness, especially relative roundness, when we're not making it quantitative? What can we call the grains that are very smoothed out versus those that are very angular? Well, we have terms like angular, and as you saw on the last slide, sometimes there's very angular, but many people just use angular, sub-rounded, and rounded. And of course, on the previous slide as well, you see well-rounded. Sometimes people use more precise terminology and go out to well-rounded or very angular and keep adding terms to make it more precise. But in general, these are some of the terms that we use to describe the angularity or roundness, or what I term smoothness, of the grains in a rock. And again, here with this depiction, you can see very well that it's very different than sphericity. You can see that the elongated grains can still have a degree of angularity and roundness without being spherical, and the spherical grains can still be very angular without being rounded. So very different terms. And before we move on, I do want to just say that up here in the top part of this figure, it shows sorting from very poorly sorted to very well sorted grains. And you can see that it just kind of means that the grains are either really variable in size or all the grains are pretty equal sized. And we talked about sorting a little bit in the last video, but I just want to briefly mention here that, as you can see, typically with increased transport, you increase sorting, and therefore you're also increasing roundness. So if you see a very well sorted deposit, it's probably also pretty well rounded, and vice versa. If you see a very poorly sorted deposit, it might be pretty poorly rounded, but that's not always the case. So that's just a general rule of thumb you can go by. But if you see something that negates that, that's totally possible. That just means it has a different depositional history, and it might be pretty useful to look at those relationships when looking at rocks in the field and trying to determine depo environment. Now, this last section in the video, I want to focus mostly on minor features, which aren't minor in their importance, but minor in their size. So minor features or micro surface textures on grains are independent of grain size, shape, and roundness. And unlike roundness, shape, or size, they require very little abrasion and transport to modify. They're very easily erased. For example, if we think of a pebble with glacial striations are sometimes very micro features on a surface of a grain that can become easily erased after a short tumble down a stream, whereas it would take a very long tumble down a stream to round a grain or reduce its size. Therefore, surface textures record the last cycle of transport. That is, we know that the surface texture preserved in the rock that we are now examining must have been a remnant of the very last cycle of its transport, because if it was transported once and given a surface texture and then transported again, the previous surface texture would have been erased and a new one would have resulted. In general, there are two major classes of surface textures that we'll talk about. First, there is those that classify the dullness or the polish or shine of a grain surface. And then there's those that classify microrelief features like striations or scratches or percussion marks, etc. So let's talk first about the polish or kind of surface luster or gloss on grains or rocks. Well, first and foremost, polish results from regularity of light reflection, whereas dull or matte surfaces are a result of the scattering or diffusion of light. So what processes can alter a grain surface so much that it has this polished appearance? Grains can become polished by gentle abrasion by fine grains. It's kind of, or exactly, the same concept as sandpaper. The finer you get in your sandpaper choice, the smoother your surface will eventually become, and eventually it will start to look polished or shiny because you went so fine that it became so smooth that it has this nice regular reflection of light. An example of a polished surface can be seen in desert varnish. We talked about desert varnish in the biomineralization part 2 video about how desert varnish can be biologically mediated in its formation. But once it's formed, the polish can result from abiotic processes like sandblasting, which is basically wind-blown grains hitting the surface, making it smoother over time and eventually polished in appearance. But not all surfaces appear polished. Many are dull or matte. For example, sand grains with this matte or dull appearance are typically called frosted sand grains. And this frosting of sand grains is not fully understood, but many attribute it to aeolian abrasion. However, the processes of aeolian abrasion is largely sandblasting. So how is sandblasting both the process that makes polished surfaces and dull surfaces. How does that work? So sandblasting can cause different surface textures depending on the grain size doing the blasting. Again, with the case of desert varnish, the wind entrained or wind suspended grains are likely very fine. And these are the grains doing the blasting of the desert varnish. And because they're very fine, they will produce a polish, whereas coarser grains that are traveling by saltation on the ground of aeolian environments like deserts, rather than by suspension in the air, may cause frosting of sand grains because they're coarser rather than finer. And it goes back to this sanding analogy where coarser paper is going to get you a smooth surface, but it's going to become more matte in appearance, whereas using very fine paper will cause the surface to become more polished eventually. And if you want to know more about aeolian processes like sandblasting and abrasion, you can see my aeolian video. I will link it up here in the right corner if you want to check it out. However, I do want to mention before we move on from frosting that frosted aeolian sand grains has also been observed to occur by chemical corrosion or etching, like we talked about in the microbial weathering part one video, if you want to check that out. And this is different than the physical sandblasting process that many attribute the frosting to. The more I say frosting, the hungrier I get. Anyway, it's argued that wetting and drying cycles related to dew and evaporation could cause corrosive frosting. However, now we know that both processes can produce frosting on sand grains. Both physical abrasion and chemical corrosion both do this, and we can actually tell the difference. Chemical frosting produces an entirely frosted grain around its entire surface area, whereas physical frosting produces a grain with frost only on its protruding surfaces, because those are the only surfaces that are getting sandblasted. All these little minute details of polish versus frosting on a grain help us understand the history of that grain or those grains. And the history of each grain will tell us the history of the rock. And that will tell us the history of the deposit. And that can tell us the region's environment, the history of the region's environment altogether. So how else can we gain information about this history of the grains, rocks, deposits, and environments? Well, we can also look at microrelief features. So we just talked about polish and frost, which are more like dullness and shininess of a surface. But there's also features like striations, scratches, percussion marks, indentations, or pits that are also important and help us understand the history of these deposits. And these are more relief features. And they're termed microrelief when they're around 2 microliters or less. First, striations and scratches. Striations and scratches typically form by ice action. You can see in all these pictures over here to the right, these striations are formed by ice or glaciers that are flowing over them and scratching and scouring that surface they're flowing over, creating these linear features. And some glacial scratches or scours are visible and definitely not micro as the large features we see here, but many are. And learning to recognize those microreliefs striations is also really important for reconstructing glacial environments. Sometimes we can even reconstruct the glacial flow direction because nail head scratches, for example, are those that have a definite head or point of origin. But microrelief features like striations can also form due to deformation of a rock under pressure. For example, fault slickensides are striations that form due to the slip of a fault and, you know, rocks are sliding against each other, forming these linear features. But we can actually tell between two if we look closer at the type of striations that have been formed on the rock. 4 major types of striation patterns are typical. There's parallel, subparallel, scattered or random striations, and grid striations. Tectonically formed striations are typically parallel and smaller or more micro striations than glacial striations. They also typically exhibit a tectonic polish, so a shiny kind of surface on the slickensides, that distinguishes them from glacial markings. Subparallel and randomly oriented striations are more typical of glacial cobbles, and grid striations, those that look like a grid, are more so associated with ice jam cobbles, so still ice action, but ice jam action rather than glacial flow action or grid striations, and they're often widely spaced and or curved. We also mentioned percussion marks, which are concentric impact scars that are common in some pebbles, like typically cherts and quartzites, so silica material, and these small markings are caused by blows to the surface indicative of high velocity flow, aka they indicate a fluvial rather than a beach depositional environment. And these percussion marks, like striations, can also be macro or micro. Lastly, pits or indentations can be seen on pebbles where you can see they look like they've been scooped out as if by a spoon. And again, these can either be macro, as shown in these pictures here, or micro in size. And pits are thought to form via etching during differential weathering. So again, you can check out the microbial weathering video to learn more about differential dissolution and etching processes that happen during weathering and diagenesis. The most commonly pitted grains are igneous grains, whereas fine-grained cherts and quartzites, as well as limestones, are typically smooth and not pitted. And this makes sense when we think about how pits form. Again, they form by etching or differential dissolution, which only happens if the material is differential or heterogeneous or inhomogeneous, because differential dissolution isn't going to happen if the material is purely one thing or mostly one thing, like chert is mostly just silica, and quartzites are mostly just silica, and limestones are mostly just calcite, whereas igneous grains have a lot of different components and ions, and some ions weather out or dissolve sooner or more readily than other ions. And again, I talk about this differential dissolution in that microbial weathering video, so check that out if you want to learn more about that. And that is all I have in this video, all about grain shape and micro surface textures of the grains of sedimentary rocks. And if you want to learn more about grain size or classes of sedimentary rocks and their general fabric and how it differs from igneous and metamorphic rocks, you can check out the first two videos in this SedStrat playlist. And if you want to check out any of the other topics listed down below these white arrows here, those are in my upcoming videos. And by the time you're watching this, they might be out. So if you'd like to see any of these topics, you can check out the SedStrat playlist on my channel or down below. And lastly, the two major references I'm using to make these SedStrat videos is Sedimentology and Stratigraphy by Boggs and Sedimentary Rocks by Pettyjohn. Both these books, as well as other minor supporting references and image sources, are all linked in my description below. And again, thank you guys so much for watching, and I can't wait to see you guys next time. Bye!